Our Lord says to us in Isaiah chapter 66, "Heaven is my throne, and earth is my footstool." Earth, we understand that part, right? Earth, the place where we live, the planet that we reside on with its circumference of 40,000 kilometers around. Earth, with all of the activities that go on this planet, man's activities, man's accomplishments, man's advances, and God says, it's mine. Heaven is my throne, earth is mine, is my footstool. Earth to us is big, right? It's a huge thing. It's that which consumes our normal lives. It's where we are. It's filled with 7.4 billion people, and we have presidents and we have prime ministers who think they are running the show, but God says that earth is my footstool. That's all it is. It's a footstool. It's a place where I put my feet, God says. In other words, all things on this planet, all things on earth, every person, all event are under the feet of God. Heaven is my throne. I'm the king. I rule over all things. I, the lofty one, reign. Where are we? We are under him. God also goes on to say, himself speaking in Isaiah 66, and this is the one that I look at down there on my footstool. I peculiarly have favorable gazes from my throne in heaven down on this one. He says, the one who is of a poor and a contrite spirit. I look particularly with favor from heaven down to my footstool, and I look for those who are poor in spirit. They understand who they are. That they have nothing and that they can do nothing, they can achieve nothing to try and please me in their own efforts. I look down and I recognize those who are poor and of a contrite spirit. And then he says, and they're the same ones who tremble at my word. They listen to me. They recognize my word is different to man's word. They recognize that when they hear my voice, it impacts them, and they actually not only want to listen, they want to do what it says. You see, that's the type of heart, that heart when it hears God's word, that's the heart that will bow before the king. That's the will of man that will submit to the will of God. And so that humble heart not only hears what God says, he trembles at what God says, and he therefore does, or she does, what God says. You say, why are you saying all this? Well, it's good for us to be reminded of this as we come to a part of the Bible, as we come back to Matthew chapter 6, where we've been finding ourselves in recent weeks, because Jesus is speaking. The God-man is speaking, and he's been speaking specifically about prayer. He's specifically been telling us how God wants us to approach him in prayer. And that is, therefore, you see, if we have those humble hearts, those hearts that tremble at his word, then what Jesus tells us in the Sermon on the Mount in relation to prayer will actually impact us. It will change us. And so we can anticipate, when we listen to what Jesus says about how to pray, it ought to transform our prayer life. So let me ask you, if you've been with us for the last few weeks as we've been going through the first section about prayer, has it done that? As you have listened to what Jesus says over these last few weeks, has it impacted you? Like, are you now more conscious of vain repetition in your prayer? Are you now more mindful? Why do I pray? What is my motivation to pray? Do I want other people to see me to pray? That's really my motivation. Why do I pray? And did hearing what Jesus said to us last week cause you through this previous week to stop and to think, even before you prayed, who it is you're praying to? You see, this is what's going to happen if we're really listening to the preaching of God's word. And if it is God's word, it will have that effect on hearts that are humble, because they are the hearts that our King, he is ruling in heaven above, and he looks down with favor upon, even as they receive his own words. And so let me just remind you where we are. We're in Matthew chapter 6. There's a parallel passage in Luke. But in Matthew chapter 6, we are really coming into what we commonly call the Lord's Prayer in these studies. And we considered last time that before we even rush into the time of prayer that we may have privately, we ought to pause. Not just sort of go through the motion. We ought to stop and we ought to consider who it is that we're speaking to, that He is our Father. That's how it starts, right? And if we really understand the Father, who the Father is, the fatherhood of God, if we really get that from the Bible and understand what all of that means, it's going to be like a magnet that will draw us that we do actually want to pray to Him. Our Father who is in heaven. You see, we can't think of heaven without thinking, remember what we saw last week, we can't think of heaven without thinking of God. It's His dwelling place. And of God's majesty and of God's sovereignty and of God's purity. That's the God we approach in prayer. And so we dare not come flippantly in prayer. We dare not come casually like we're having a chat or we're talking to somebody on the phone. If we do, then we've lost sight of who God is. Or we maybe have never known who God is. Now it's a great shame that the Lord's Prayer for so many is only recited like a poem. Or maybe we ourselves, we quickly read it, we skim over it, and the full significance of each part of the prayer is lost on us. And so to help us understand, we're slowing down in our study through the Sermon on the Mount to digest in smaller parts and to hopefully help us learn how to pray from this part of the Scriptures. Jesus knows, remember, that all His disciples, they do actually need help to know how to pray. And so in love, He's giving us then the great help we all know we need, even to know what to pray. So He gives us what we are calling this model prayer. It's a pattern prayer, the Lord's Prayer, for us to imitate. And so if we just have a look at the prayer, if I invite you to look in your Bibles at Matthew 6, we're not going to read it, I know we're all familiar with it, but I just invite you to look at the paragraph for us just to have a quick overview of this prayer. Last time we just began by seeing in the start of verse 9 of the one that we approach in prayer and how we are to approach Him. And then what we actually see, if we just break it apart quickly to give you the big picture, we've got two big sections then in the Lord's Prayer. There are actually two sections of petitions. They're grouped into three petitions each. The first three petitions deal with God's glory, about His name, about His kingdom, about His will. And then there's a second group of three, some would even say four petitions, we could argue about that. And they are not about God's glory directly, they are about man's need. Give us our bread, forgive us and deliver us and so on. And then of course we know there is what's called the benediction. Okay, so that's the structure of the prayer. We approach God, our Father in heaven, and then there are two sets of three petitions. Godward and manward, and then there's the benediction. Okay, so you should all understand the content then, the big picture, the content of the prayer. And so today we're going to move now into the petitions. But before we just come directly into the petitions, I want to just underscore an obvious thing that we can miss. And that is, let me just say it again, that the first part of this prayer, that the primary thing, the first thing, the priority that God would have us pray about relates to Him. Look with me now as we come into the verses themselves. Our Father, verse 9, in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. You see, they're all about God. Now think about your own prayers. Is that how you pray? Is that how you commence in your prayers? Do your prayers reflect this emphasis, this priority for God and His glory? This is why this prayer is given to us. But I think we all know how it normally goes, right? Lord, Father, help me. Help me in my distress. I've got this need. Please help me with my need. Please take my headache away. I'm having trouble in my studies. Please help me. I'm having trouble in my job. Please give me a different one. My grandma's got cancer. Please help her. Heal her. Me, Lord. My. Isn't that how it more often goes. Well, Jesus, you see, shows us a better way. It's a better way because it's his way. And his way is always best. It's a new way maybe for us. He teaches us how to pray. This is how I want you to pray. That's what he says in verse 9. In this manner, therefore, pray. So whatever need we've got, whatever be the concern or maybe a crisis that we might be facing in our lives, here is how God wants us to pray. At the outset, we see this. And so God, you keep right here, God's asking, do you tremble at my word? Then listen to what I say about prayer. Before you begin even to think about all your particular petitions that you've got and your needs, even before the concern of others, we must start with this great concern about God, His glory, His purposes, His work on His footstool, the earth. And so we see in the second half of verse 9 and into verse 10, all the three petitions, the three requests, we might call them, they're all Godward. And so I'm entitled this morning's sermon, A God-Focused Prayer. Now, time's not going to allow us to unpack all three. I was hoping to do that, but I think there's greater benefit just to slow it down just a little. So we're going to do two. I don't know what that means for next week, but we're going to do the first two. We're going to look at God's name and then God's kingdom. Okay? So let's see that in the prayer. Firstly, the first petition is, we're all familiar with it, but what does it mean? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Hallowed. Now, what's that? Do we use that word? Maybe the closest is Halloween, like trying to get a word that's close that we use. We don't use, it's an odd word, it's an old word, but don't be afraid of it. It simply has this idea of giving high honor to. And so in other words, it's to acknowledge God's magnificence. It's to adore Him. It's to delight in Him as we approach Him in prayer. Hallowed, highly esteemed, as it were, very high honor we give to your name. Your name? Now that expression, God's name, is speaking, I think, far more than just about the names the Bible gives to God. You know, like, Jehovah Jireh is one we often think about, or Jehovah Shalom, the Lord is peace. We could add a lot to them. And certainly it's true, we are to be careful. We are to be careful how we speak about God, and we are not to use His name lightly, and we are not to trample God's name in the dust by loosely using Him in our speech. We are never, well, we would never do that with someone we highly respect. Would we? We would never do that with someone we have high affection for, so we won't do it with God if we have high honor and esteem for Him. And yet let me suggest to you that the primary idea of this reference to God's name is not so much the names that we can give to God, though that is relevant, but it's more probably the biblical idea that God's name, that represents God's being. It represents God's attributes, who God is, what He is like. And so this hallowing is to acknowledge, it's to deeply appreciate who God is in the breadth of His character. And so can you see, it's an act of praise, but it's also a petition. It's a petition that His great name, that His character may be grasped, that it may be valued with awe and wonder by many people. It's really like a prayer that God may be glorified. So that therefore means rushing into prayer with our list of requests, which is our tendency. Before we do that, here's how the Lord Himself wants us to start our prayers in petition, thinking firstly of who God is. The God who reveals Himself in His holy word. Not just picking one part that we like, that fits our little situation or our understanding, but by faith embracing all that God reveals to Himself about Himself, whether we understand it or not. That God is infinite in power. We can't understand that. We don't have a capacity with a finite mind to understand the infinite, how you measure that. You can't. But God is infinite in power. He is boundless in love. He is perfect in holiness. He's complete in knowledge, is he not? He's consistent in justice. He's supreme in sovereignty. He's abounding in goodness. And of course we know he is amazing in grace. He's the Ancient of Days. He's the one who was and is to come. This is the God who we are to highly value and honor. Hallowed be his name, who he is. David, in Psalm 34, said something similar to this petition when he said, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together." You remember from our study last week that the Lord's Prayer has a corporate dimension to it. It's not my Father in heaven, remember? It's our Father in heaven. But as I pray this first petition about God's name, I am including myself. David's including himself in his expression, "Magnify the Lord with me." And so we can't actually pray this petition, if you stop and think for a moment, we can't actually honestly pray this petition for God to be highly honored and God to be glorified if we're not actually living that way. I mean, what would God think? If we prayed, we're supposed to be speaking to him, and we prayed, "May your name, Lord, be glorified. May you be hallowed and lifted high." And then we left that place of prayer and we went out through the day and we lived as if God didn't exist. And we lived for our own self and our own glory. You see, that's really hypocritical in the furthest extent of expression. You see, to pray this prayer is basically to pray, "Lord, I actually need help to live today for your glory. I want to see your name spread. I want to see the fame of Christ declared, but I need your help. And so I'm even asking this even before you." You think of the Lord Jesus, surely, though we don't have the recorded prayers of Jesus praying all through the night, up on the mountains and up early in the morning, but surely he would have been praying this very flavor, would have been in his prayer. And we know Jesus just wouldn't have prayed this. We know Jesus lived this prayer. Whilst he was on earth, his passionate concern was for the glory of the Father. And so right at the end of his ministry in John chapter 17, remember, it's actually the record of one of his prayers, praying to the Father, and he says, "I have glorified you on this earth, Father. I have manifest your name to the men who you have given me out of this world." And so there's a sense in which not just his prayer, but his whole life, he could honestly pray that. His whole life was about hallowing God's name. And of course, the whole thing is building, 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 and it comes to a crescendo at the cross. The great character of God, all the attributes of God are put on display in no clearer place in history than at Calvary. You think about that. It's the greatest display, the cross, of the attributes of God. Because there on the cross was exalted the God who is perfect in holiness. He's consistent in justice. And so it was fair that he should punish Christ. And yet, whilst at the same time, he's boundless in love. Now, it's the normal standard thing when people think of Christ as Christians, well, it's just love. No, it's not. It's not just love. Love means nothing unless it's got a broader context. It's true love if it's in the context of the aspect of the judgment of sin. That Christ would lay down his life in that very setting. The God of wrath, he must punish sin. And yet he's merciful. And in his kindness, in that very act, he's providing salvation for sinners who don't deserve it. And so, yes, it's true, the great love of God is demonstrated at the cross. It's a wonderful demonstration of the love of God. But his justice is also displayed. And this is where that expression we sometimes sing in one of the hymns that we sing, it's taken from the Old Testament, that mercy and justice kiss. Where do mercy and justice kiss? They kiss at Calvary. That's where they come together. How does that happen? We believe it by faith, but we can't fully understand it. This is the God of the Bible. And so, friends, as we come back to this first petition in the Lord's Prayer, hallowed be your name. It reveals then a burning desire, not just in my life, but the petition is broader, that the whole world might bow before God in adoration and praise. This is number one petition. What's it about? It's not about me. It's about God's name. The overarching desire I have, Jesus says, as I pray this way, according to His will, is I pray for the glory of God. And so it's not to pray in the first place for my comforts. It's not to pray for me to gather and have more goodies. The Christian life is not about great health and accumulating wealth. It's about God and His glory. You see, Christian friend, here's actually a prayer. Just stop and think. Here's a prayer that we can pray, this petition, when we're facing a trial, even if it may be a physical trial that relates to our own health. We can stop, we can think, we can pause, we can ponder. We ask the question, why has God given me this? Why have I got this trial? Well, what's the answer to that? Well, the big answer to that big question is it's for God's glory. Now, can we pull that apart and understand that all in the specifics? Probably not. But it is what God reveals to us, and by faith we lay hold of that. But just think of Jesus. Jesus is pursuing the glory of God all through His life. You see, this whole idea that supposedly that the perfect Christian life is a smooth road where there's great health and there's great wealth does not fit the Bible. It does not fit the life of the Savior Himself. Jesus' pursuit of God's glory, did that always mean a smooth road with tontine cushion comfort for our Lord Jesus? It certainly did not. Sometimes the pathway for God's glory can be a little rough, and it can be painful. And if you're struggling to understand that and see that, well, go and study the character of Job. And if you're done with him, then have a look at Joseph. And if you're done with him, have a look at David. Have a look at Jeremiah. Have a look at Daniel. Have a look at Paul. And just look at Jesus. Sometimes we've got to ask these big questions. Like, why is this footstool here? Why is planet Earth seemingly hanging in space? It's all for God's glory. Why are you and I on His footstool? For God's glory. And so you see, this petition God would have us pray, well, this is how He wants us to pray, is that He would be highly valued and honored in all things, not just the easy things and the things that we like, but in all things and in every place, everywhere. That's coming to that point of the wonder of who God is that then flows out to a sense of praise because of who He is, that very thing would be spread in our day, spread in our family. Spread in our community. Spread with those that you work with. Spread with those that you see in the shops. That you, Lord, the God of perfection, would be adored by more and more people in our day. Oh, may your name, Lord, be more deeply appreciated even by those who call themselves your people. What would we say but to so much of today in the Christian church, away with all the trivial, away with all the trendy things, that you, Lord, would show them who you really are and what you are truly like, that all the games would stop and that your glory would consume us. Highly honored. Oh, highly honored be your name, Father. That all the prosperity preachers, that all the personalities and all the programs that are in the way would move aside, and that you, Lord, would become central again. And Lord, may I be slower in my prayers to rush to all my needs, And may I give greater concentration to you and your name. That much glory be brought to your name. Hallowed be your name. The second petition we move now to consider, we've seen God's name. Second one is God's kingdom. Jesus again is teaching us what else he wants us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. This second petition, I think you'll see this, naturally follows the first petition, but it's like it builds on the first petition. And yet here's really the question. That we've got the first petition. We desire, Lord, that your glory would be spread abroad, that men everywhere and women everywhere would be adoring you, who would actually know who you are and they would delight in you, that would happen everywhere. Now, are all people on God's footstool today exalting his name? Of course, we know the answer to that is no. The vast majority probably are not. Why? Well, there's another kingdom. There's a kingdom of sin. Or more specifically, there is Satan's kingdom, the kingdom of darkness, the Bible calls it, over which the devil rules. And so, yes, it's right. Here is our desire as Christians that we want God's name, that it would be more glorified. But the moment we start to go down that pursuit, we soon realize, oh man, there's real opposition to this. The God of this age, Satan, he's opposed to God himself. He's opposed to this agenda of wanting to see the glory of God expand and the honor of God being known. But here for us as Christians, this is where the promises of the Scriptures, the revelation of God, of what he is doing in this world to us is so helpful to help us keep our feet on the ground and yet our heads in the right place as well and our hearts in the right place. You remember from the dawn of time, God gave a promise. The first gospel promise happened in the Garden of Eden, right? Genesis chapter 3. And in Genesis chapter 3, God effectively promises that he will send a deliverer who would come and he would crush that serpent of old. That's the devil. That he would bruise the serpent's head. Now in the process, we know what happens. His heel gets bruised. He suffers in the process of overcoming Satan. And that's the promise. That's what was given right in the Garden of Eden. And we see that, if you like, woven through all this tension between God's kingdom and Satan's kingdom down through the Old Testament. And yet it comes to its wonderful fulfillment in the Lord Jesus Christ, because in the fullness of time, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law. The Son of God broke into this world, into history, on the footstool. And Jesus, God's Son, actually became a resident on God's footstool. Think of the humility of the Son, that he would leave the throne room of heaven and come down to the footstool. And he walks on the footstool in obedience to his Father. What a glorious thought for us to think about what Jesus did and why he came. But you remember before he came, he sent John the Baptist. God sent the preacher John the Baptist. Remember the message God gave to John the Baptist? It's back in a couple of chapters in Matthew chapter 3. His message that he was to preach was, repent, turn from your sin, turn from your idolatry, turn from just your pure religion. Repent. Why? Because the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's just about here. It's just around the corner. It's just as far away as we can reach with our hand. And then, of course, Jesus comes. Mark tells us in the opening chapter of Mark that Jesus commences his ministry. Mark puts it this way. He came to Galilee. What was he doing? He was preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. Jesus came to establish the kingdom of God, and the kingdom of God is established through the gospel. Now we need to just stop for just a minute to say, well, what's this thing, the kingdom of God? Well, perhaps the simplest way for me to describe it and to help you understand it without getting into all the complexities is that the kingdom of God really means the reign of God. It means the rule of God in the hearts of men. And it's only the gospel of Christ that can bring about that change in our hearts, that God would reign in our hearts, because by nature we reign in our hearts. And it's only God coming through the gospel that changes that very thing. And so as we just think just briefly about Jesus, he's coming to establish the kingdom. How did he establish the kingdom? What did that look like in his life? Well, certainly it was through a life of obedience to God's law, and that of course meant he was resisting Satan's temptation, not just for 40 days, but for his whole 33 odd years. And of course Jesus displayed his supreme power over Satan again and again by casting out demons and casting out demons and casting out demons. But the ultimate act of establishing the kingdom of God was in his death. You may remember that parable that Jesus told, that Jesus is the one who comes to a house. There's a man that lives in the house and he's a strong man. But Jesus comes to that house and he binds that man in the house. He binds Satan. He's strong, but Jesus is stronger, and so he binds Satan. That's what he does. That's what he did in his ministry. He accomplished ultimately that strong binding victory at Calvary. Now turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Colossians. But me just briefly for us to just open up this aspect. Colossians chapter 2. Verse 13. Paul, of course, is writing to Christians in the church at Colossae and is reminding them what's happened in their lives. And you, verse 13, Colossians 2, you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven all trespasses, you all trespasses. And then he goes on to say, having wiped out the handwriting of requirement that was against us, that very declaration that we owed God something, which was contrary to us, he says, and Christ has taken it out of the way, or God has in Christ taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. And so here's really quickly, that it's through the death of Christ that he has paid our debt. The debt that we owe to God due to our sin has been paid in full, no more owed, by the Lord Jesus. So that's one thing that's happened at the cross, but there's more, he says, that happened at the cross. Verse 15. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it, in what was happening on the cross, in what happened because of the cross. Jesus disarmed. You know, when you disarm someone and you're fighting against them, guess what? You've won. You're the victor. You've taken away the power that they had to have an impact upon you for them to win. Jesus says here, he disarmed the powers of darkness, and he did it in his death on the cross. And so then Calvary is this public declaration of the victorious establishment of the kingdom of God, and that the broken power of the kingdom of darkness happened at that event. Now we could add Hebrews chapter 2 verse 4. It tells us about Jesus destroying the power of death. That is the devil, he says, through his own death. And we know so gloriously that was displayed, that the victory of his kingdom was displayed. In 3 days later, he rose from the dead. And so as we come back now, friends, as we come back to the second petition, as we need to understand what's the kingdom, how has the kingdom come to this earth, what's this petition mean, we're simply needing to see, when we say, your kingdom come, we're effectively praying, Father, you sent your one and only Son to establish your kingdom. And oh, we long to see your dominion on earth spread. We long to see that many more would come into your kingdom, that they may hear about Jesus Christ, because many don't even know his name, even in our culture now. They don't know about Jesus. They don't know who he is. But that they would not only just know about who Jesus is, but that they would know what he has done for sinners on the cross, and that hearing that good news, they would embrace that gospel, and they would be given new hearts. When you're given a new heart, this new heart, it enables you to bow, and to bow and submit, and to yield your will to King Jesus. Your kingdom come, Father. Your kingdom come. Into the hearts of men and women, boys and girls, one at a time. Has that happened to you? Has God's kingdom come to your heart? Are you in the kingdom? Have you embraced the gospel? Have you bowed your knee to King Jesus? If you have, well, what's a wonderful thing. But if you haven't, guess which kingdom you're still in? You're still in Satan's kingdom. Yes, you may be in church this morning, but if you have not embraced the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, you are still in Satan's kingdom. And you can't really pray this prayer. You can't really pray for the kingdom to come if you haven't experienced this yourself. The prayer that you need to pray is for it to be, firstly, for yourself. You see, ultimately, really, and I don't want to go over old ground, but as I've sought to show you, this prayer is actually for the disciples. It's not actually for anybody out there. This is a prayer for Christians, we might say. And in the first place, this prayer, this petition, your kingdom come, it's for Christians themselves. It's to pray, Lord, may your kingdom come. Yes, you've saved me, but may your kingdom permeate and expand more and more in my life. May I have your grace that I may live a life consistent with what I say that I believe, that I may yield to the kingdom in my life, that I may more and more taste the powers of the age to come. That I would have greater victory over Satan's temptations toward me to sin. May I grow in my appreciation, Lord, of you, my Savior. May the cross become more precious to me, because I can't think of the kingdom without thinking of the cross. I can't think of the kingdom without thinking of the empty tomb. I can't think of the kingdom without thinking of the Lord Jesus. And the only reason I'm in the kingdom, the only reason I am free from Satan's kingdom, is because of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And now that I'm in your kingdom, Lord, with all of its blessings, I want others to join me in this glorious kingdom. And so can you see, I can actually really pray this prayer as a desire in my own heart, that God's kingdom would come to me and that I would want it to come to others. But then I can't actually even pray that sincerely as a believer if I'm not personally involved in evangelism. This petition teaches us to put the spread of the gospel before our own needs, because it's the petition that comes a few before, give us our daily bread. He's put the priority for us to see what's of greater importance. Of greater importance is God's kingdom, my own little kingdom of one. This petition, I want to come back to the issue of our struggles as Christians, because it's relevant there as well. It's so relevant even when I'm in a crisis or I'm facing some trial. Because even then, God wants my higher concern to be, how can I, by the power of the Spirit, even share the gospel in this situation? Because He has placed me here in His providence, He in His wisdom, and yes, it's His goodness, He has given it to me, He has put me in the middle of this tough patch, for His kingdom's sake. Lord, may your kingdom come. May it expand directly, even through the unique contacts that I've now got in my life because of this unusual set of circumstances. You see, it's a relevant petition wherever we are in our life, even as a Christian. And as I began to hint before, it's a petition for Christians to pray for others. And really, your kingdom come is like a missions prayer. Could we say it that way? It's a prayer at another level for evangelism, that the gospel of the kingdom might spread throughout all of God's footstool, all the nations, wherever they are on that footstool, that the kingdom of Satan and sin would be destroyed as God's gospel is propagated everywhere. That is, the kingdom of darkness would be retreating as the light of the gospel is penetrating into those dark areas. That's the prayer. As we pray, your kingdom come, can you not also see as a result of this very prayer, in light of Matthew 28, the Great Commission, and what Jesus expected would happen, and what happened in the book of Acts when the gospel went out and people were baptized, and what happened? They were brought into churches and churches were established. That's the pattern. And so we can pray, your kingdom come, and we've also got in the back of our minds, informed from the Bible itself, we are praying for the Church of Christ, that it may even in our day be free and be able to be unhindered to carry out her task, not only of worship, but of witness in our community. That we may have the freedom to do what we're doing today. We're adoring God's name, are we not? We're involved in declaring the wonder of God. We're involved in encouraging one another in the kingdom work and even preaching the gospel in this context. We don't want that to be hindered. And so we pray, Lord, may your kingdom come, and that will have an impact, a ramification, an implication of that. Lord, we are praying that you would restrain the governments from changing their laws. It's also a prayer that we may pray for God to raise up men in particular who are here. He is calling in his own sovereignty to go and to represent us and be our missionaries. That happens in Acts. The church at Antioch sending out people to preach the gospel, to establish churches. So as we pray, may your kingdom come, we know what this means in practice. As we see it worked out in the New Testament, we can pray for God to raise up gospel preachers to go and proclaim the message of the kingdom. There can be no true new churches established without gospel preaching. And we're therefore praying for God to raise up solid biblical churches who would be shining lights for his kingdom and in his kingdom. And I'm talking about Christ-exalting, Bible-saturated, Spirit-empowered churches who love the cross, who love the Lord Jesus, who love the gospel. Because it's the gospel that has the explosive power to impact our society. It's the gospel that will blow apart Satan's dark kingdom. And our prayer is, Lord, may your kingdom come even in that way, that more and more people would bow the knee to King Jesus and they would serve in his kingdom alongside us. You see, the preaching of Jesus Christ and him crucified is the powerful weapon for the kingdom of God to come now onto his footstool. And yet there's something bigger, and we're going to close at this point and come to the Lord's Supper. There's something bigger about the kingdom of God. We need to understand that the term and the idea in the Bible of the kingdom of God has a twofold dimension. It has this idea that it's now, but it's also got this idea that it's not yet. That's not a contradiction. It's how the Bible presents it, and you'll probably understand what I'm saying, that the kingdom of God, yep, it has already come in one sense. It's present in the heart of all of those who are truly saved. Christ reigns in such people. His kingdom has come to them. But there is a day coming when the kingdom of God will be consummated, we would say. Every knee will bow then. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father, that he is actually the King. And you see, the whole message of the Bible, especially the New Testament, where more light is given, though it is in the Old Testament, the whole thing is moving forward to a day yet to come when Christ will once more break into human history. Christ will again leave heaven, and he's going to come back to the footstool, and he's going to finish human history the next time. That day's coming. And so can you see this petition? It's relevant to that part of history that's yet to come, that aspect of the kingdom of God, so that the true child of God can say, "Oh Lord, yes, your kingdom come now to the earth, into the hearts of men through the gospel, and I want to be involved in that work. But, oh Lord, your kingdom come in this other greater sense, this other further sense, this other sense." We're simply saying, "Lord, hasten the day." Isn't that really how the Bible finishes? Don't you love the way the Bible finishes? It finishes with that point of hope for people who are under persecution in the days of John, in the early church. The very last couple of verses. Revelation 22:20, Jesus himself speaks one more time in the Bible and he says, "Surely I am coming quickly." And John responds and he says, "Oh yes, bring it on, Lord." That's what he's saying in our language today. "Even so, come, Lord Jesus." And so can you see this petition, this second petition? We are praying to the Father that the Father may do what he has planned to do. Do we know when that is? No. That's in the secret counsels of God. But he has planned to do it. He's actually very kindly revealed to us before he's going to do it that he is going to do that. This is part of his plan. And so we can pray with confidence, "Lord, bring an end to history. Usher in the new age of your glory." But let me just check this again. Because the only ones who can truly pray this prayer, this petition for Christ's kingdom to come in its consummation, are those who are ready to stand before the judge on that day. Are you ready for his coming? You see, to pray your kingdom come, it implies that I'm prepared for that coming. To pray your kingdom come, it actually is to pray, "I am eager for it to come. I can't wait for it to come. Bring it on, Lord." To pray your kingdom come in this fullest and final sense is to actually show that I'm not attached to this world. And that I can let go of this world with no sense of, "Oh, I don't want to leave that. Oh, I love my new car." Even as a Christian, we need this prayer, do we not? Even for that point, that my focus is to be Christ. His cross is to be Godward. It is to be God's glory. It is to be God's name. It is to be God's kingdom. What does God want us to pray in our prayers? Well, we are beginning to see something of that answered in the Lord's Prayer. "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come." Now, Lord willing, next week we'll take up the third petition. What does it mean? "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Well, let's bow together, friends. Let's briefly pray before we will come to the Lord's table. Almighty God, we thank you for who you are. And we do thank you that we don't have the capacity to get our mind around all that you are, because if we could, then you would be so small. We pray for the faith to believe what you reveal yourself to be and to leave some questions unanswered as you would have us leave them. We pray, Lord, for the priority that this prayer shows us, that you want us to have, not just in our prayer life, but in our lives, to have a priority for your glory and to have a priority for your kingdom. But we also want to thank you this morning that central in even what we've considered is what we're about to do now as a people, to be reminded and to delight and worship you because of Jesus Christ and him crucified. And so bless us now, Lord, as we come from your word, as we sing and as we come to your table. We ask in Jesus' name.
Amen.